This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Chronicles of Fairyland by Fergus Hume. Poem: A Ballad of Fairy Tales. 1. O'er weary earth the twilight falls, the sunset fades from western skies, dark shadows dance upon the walls, as from the hearth red flames arise. This hour is full of strange surprise, of mystic stories sweet and grand, and children hear with shining eyes these chronicles of Fairyland. 2. So, children, gather round my knee and list to tales of old romance, with stories of the land and sea, I'll make your eyes with pleasure dance. And if the fays are kind, perchance you'll see in dreams the elfish band, whene'er you hear with wandering glance these chronicles of Fairyland. 3. The rugged caves where giants dwell, the dragons guarding gems and gold, fair ladies who by magic spell are held enchained in castles old, the handsome princes, brave and bold, who cross the moat by drawbridge spanned, such tales and more will now unfold these chronicles of Fairyland. Envoy. Then, children, leave your books and toys, and come to this enchanted strand. I tell for happy girls and boys these chronicles of Fairyland. End of poem. Chapter 1. King Oberon's Library. It was after dinner, I think, as I was seated in my armchair before the fire, tired out with hard work, and therefore half asleep. All day long it had been snowing hard, and even now, at 7 o'clock in the evening, it was still coming down in great white flakes, making the earth look like a beautiful birthday cake. There was no light in the room, except the red glimmer of the fire that flickered and flared on the wide hearth, roaring up the great chimney, as if it was grumbling to itself at having to go out into the cold, cold night. Now, I am very fond of the firelight in a dark room at such an hour, for it casts strange shadows, which put strange fancies into my head, and I tell these strange fancies to good children, which pleases them very much. For the children I tell them to are very wise, and believe in these strange fancies, calling them fairy tales, as indeed they are. Grown-up people do not believe in fairy tales, which is a great pity, because there are many good and beautiful stories told of the fairies, which make people who really understand them better and wiser. But all children understand them, because all children know that Fairyland exists, and therefore, the strange fancies called fairy tales must necessarily be true. Well, as I said before, I was seated half asleep in my armchair in the dark, watching the fire burning merrily on the hearth, and sending out great shafts of red light to explore dark corners where goblins are fond of lurking. On the roof and on the wall danced the firelight shadows in the most amusing manner, but they are foolish folk, these same shadows, belonging to the strange kingdom of Shadowland, which lies near the realm of Faery, yet not mingling with it in any way, for in Fairyland, as wise children know, there are no shadows at all. I grew tired watching the shadow dance, so, letting my chin sink on my breast, I stared into the red hollows and burning caverns made by the flames among the logs of wood. There I saw all kinds of curious things, turreted castles which held enchanted princesses, broad red plains, across which journeyed brave knights in armor to deliver those same princesses, and huge rocky caverns wherein dwelt cruel magicians who try to stop the brave knights from reaching the enchanted castles. I saw all these things in the fire, and you can see them also if you look steadily into the flames at night time, because then everything is under the spell of fairy power. But you must believe very hard indeed, as you look, for the fairies will not let their country be seen by children who doubt that the beautiful land exists. There were some twigs on the logs still bearing a few withered leaves, but being out of reach of the fire, they were not burnt up. Nevertheless, The flames made them quiver with their hot breath, just as if they were still being shaken by the cool breeze of the forest. Now, while I was looking at the shaking of the withered leaves, a cricket began to chirp, and whether it was the magic of the darkness or the influence of the fairies, I do not know, but I understood every word of the song the cricket sang. Oh, it was really a famous singer, that merry cricket, and the song it sang went something after this fashion. The cricket's song. You can only hear my voice, but you cannot see me. Oh, would not your heart rejoice if you could but be me? Through the sultry summer hours, my shrill voice was ringing. Now, when cold has killed the flowers, by the fire I'm singing. You don't understand my song, though so bright and airy, for to mortals you belong, you are not a fairy. Living now the earth upon, oft my life's imperiled, but at court of Oberon, I'm the fairy's herald. If you caught me, you would say, in the fire stick it, in the house it shall not stay, noisy, noisy cricket. Therefore, by the fairy king, I to hide am bidden, and you only hear me sing when I'm closely hidden. First of all, it sounded as if only one cricket was singing, then a second seemed to join in, afterwards a third and fourth, until the whole forest appeared to be full of crickets. Forest? Yes, I was now in an old, old forest, for, as I listened to the cricket's song, the twigs on the logs became fresh and green, then seemed to grow larger and larger, until they hid the red light of the fire and branched out with great leafy boughs into the room. I looked up in surprise and saw the green branches, high above my head, waving in the soft wind, and I could hear the singing of unseen birds sound through the chirping of the crickets. Under my feet, instead of a carpet, there was now fresh green turf covered with daisies, and my armchair was a chair no longer, but the mossy trunk of a fallen tree. The red light glimmered behind the leaves, as though the fire was still there, but I knew in some strange way that it was not the fire, but the crimson glare of the sunset. A great wave of fantasy seemed to roll through the forest, and I started to my feet, as the crickets finished singing, with a curious sense of wonderful knowledge and vague longings. Dear me, I said to myself, this must be Fairyland. Yes, it is Fairyland, piped a shrill voice, which seemed to come from the ground. This is the forest of enchantment. Yes, it is Fairyland, piped a shrill voice. I looked down without astonishment, for in Fairyland no one is astonished at the strange things which take place, and saw an old, old little man, with a long white beard, sitting astride the stem of a flower, which kept swaying up and down like a rocking horse. He was dressed in bright green, with the inverted purple cup of a Canterbury bell on his head, and if he had not spoken I would not have known he was there. So much did his clothes and cap resemble the surrounding green grass and colored flowers. Goblin? I asked quickly, for you see, he looked so old and ugly that I thought he must be one of the underground fairies. I'm not a goblin, he replied in an angry, shrill voice, like the wind whistling through a keyhole. It is very rude of you to call me a goblin, a nasty thing, who lives under the earth and only cares for gold and silver. I'm a fairy, a very celebrated fairy indeed. But you wear a beard, I said doubtfully. Fairies don't wear beards. Not all fairies, he answered with dignity, jumping down from his swaying flower stem. But I do, because I am the librarian of King Oberon. Dear me. I did not know he had a library. Do let me see it. You see it now, said the librarian, waving his hand. Look at all the books. I looked round, but saw nothing except a circle of trees, whose great boughs, meeting overhead, made a kind of leafy roof, through which could be seen the faint rosy flush of the sunset sky. The ground, as I said before, was covered with daisy-sprinkled turf, and there was a still pool of shining water in the center, upon the bosom of which floated large white lilies. "I must say I don't see anything except leaves," I said after a pause. "Well, those are the books." "Oh, are they? Well, I know books have leaves, but I didn't know leaves were books." The fairy looked puzzled. "You must have some fairy blood in you," he said at length, "or you would never have found your way into this forest. But you don't seem to have enough of the elfin nature to see all the wonders of Fairyland." "Oh, do let me see the wonders of Fairyland," I asked eagerly. "Now that I am here, I want to see everything." "No doubt you do," retorted the fairy with a provoking smile, "but I don't know if the king will let you. However, I'll ask him when he wakes." "Is he asleep?" I said in astonishment. "Why, it's daytime." "It's daytime with you, not with us," answered the librarian. "The night is the day of the fairies, and see, there's the sun rising." Looking up through the fretwork of boughs and leaves, I saw the great silver shield of the moon trembling in the dark blue sky, from whence all the sunset colors had died away. "But that's the moon," I cried, laughing. "The moon is our sun, stupid," he said tartly. "I think the king will be awake now, so I'll ask him if you can see the books." He vanished, I don't know how, for though I did not take my eyes off him, he seemed to fade away, and in his place I saw the green leaves and slender stem of a flower, with the Canterbury bell nodding on the top. The only thing I could do was to wait, so I sat down again on the fallen tree and amused myself with looking round to see what kind of creatures lived in Fairyland. The night was very still, no sound of cricket or bird, not even the whisper of the wind or the splash of water. All was silent, and the moon, looking down through the leaves, flooded the glade with a cold, pale light, turning the still waters of the pool to a silver mirror upon which slept the great white lilies. Suddenly a bat, whirring through the glade, disappeared in the soft dusk of the trees. Then I heard the distant too-wit, too-woo of an owl, which seemed to break the spell of the night and awaken the sleeping fairies, for all at once on every side I heard a confused murmur. The glowworms lighted their glimmering lamps on the soft mossy banks, and brilliant fireflies flashed like sparkling stars through the perfumed air. Then a nightingale began to sing. I could not see the bird, but only heard the lovely music gushing from amid the dim gloom of the leaves, filling the whole forest with exquisite strains. I understood the nightingale's song just as well as I did that of the cricket, but what it sang was much more beautiful. The nightingale's song. The day has furled her banners red, and all the world lies cold and dead. All light and gladness fled. Asleep, asleep in slumber deep, our maiden boy, and grief and joy and pleasures, pains are bound, fast bound in slumber's chains. Ah, slumbers keep the maid who sighs, the boy who cries, the bee that flies in charmed sleep. See how the moon shines in the sky, her light so pale o'er hill and dale, o'er dale and hill, so calm and still, in splendor flinging, and Mother Earth at her bright birth hears me the nightbird singing. 'Tis I, who in the darkness cry, the nightingale who sings on high. I call the elves to show themselves, they creep from tree, from grass, from flower, in forest bower at midnight hour, they dance all night so bright, so light, while I the woods with song entrance. Singing, singing, my voice is ringing throat the still leaves till all the dark night heaves with pain again, oh, sing again, bring joy, bring tears till o'er the lawn the red, red dawn appears, appears, appears. While the nightingale was thus singing in such a capricious manner, paying no attention to meter or rhyme, the whole glade changed. But I was so entranced with the bird music that I did not notice the transformation until I found myself in a splendid hall with a lofty ceiling, seated on a couch of green velvet. The trees around were now tall, slender pillars of white marble, and between them hung long curtains of emerald velvet. The pool was still in the center, with its broad white water lilies asleep on its breast, but it was now encircled by a rim of white marble and reflected not the blue sky, but an azure ceiling, upon which fantastic patterns in gold reminded me somewhat of the intricate traceries of the trees. High up in the oval ceiling, in place of the moon, there hung a large opaque globe, from whence a soft, cool light radiated through the apartment. As I was looking at all these beautiful things, I heard a soft laugh, and on turning round, saw a man of my own height, dressed in robes of pale green, with a sweeping white beard, a purple cap on his head, and a long, slender staff in his hands. "You don't know me," he said in a musical voice. "My name is Fancy, and I am the librarian of the king." "Were you the fairy?" I asked, looking at him. "I am always a fairy," he replied, smiling. "You saw me as I generally appear to mortals, but, as the king has given you permission to learn some of the secrets of Fairyland, I now appear to you in my real form." "So, this is the king's library," I said, looking round. "But how did I come here, or rather, how did the glade change to the library?" "The glade has not changed at all," said Fancy quietly. "It is still around you, but your eyes have been unsealed, and you now see beneath the surface." "But I don't understand," I observed, feeling perplexed. "It is difficult," assented Fancy gravely, "but I can show you what I mean by an illustration. When you see a grub, it only looks to your eyes an ugly brown thing. But my eyes can see below the outside skin, to where a beautiful butterfly is lying with folded wings of red and gold. The glade you saw was, so to speak, the skin of the library. Now, your sight has been made keen by the command of the king. You see this splendid room. It is still the glade and still the room, only it depends upon your sight being lightened or darkened. It doesn't look a bit like the glade." "You don't think so, of course," said Fancy kindly, "but I will explain. The white pillars are the trunks of the trees, the green curtains between are the green leaves, the ceiling is the blue sky, the white globe that gives light is the moon, and the golden fretwork on the ceiling is the leaves and boughs of the trees shining against the clear sky." "And the books?" I asked quickly. "Here are the books," he replied, drawing one of the green curtains a little on one side, "and there I saw rows of volumes in brown covers, which reminded me somewhat of the tint of the withered leaves." "You can stay here as long as you like," said Fancy, dropping the curtain, "and read all the books." "Oh, I can't stay long enough for that," I said regretfully. "I would be missed from my house." "No, you would not," he replied. "Time in Fairyland is different from time on Earth. 5 minutes with you means 5 years with us, so if you stay here 30 years, you will only have been away from Earth half an hour." "But I'm afraid." "Still unconvinced," interrupted Fancy a little sadly, leading me forward to the pool of water. "You mortals never believe anything but what you see with your own eyes. Look." He waved his white wand, and the still surface of the water quivered as if a breeze had rippled across it. Then it became still again, and I saw my own room, and myself seated asleep in the armchair in front of a dull red fire. I closed my eyes for a moment, and when I looked again, the vision had vanished. "How is it my body is there, and I am here?" I asked, turning to Fancy. "What you saw is your earthly body," he said quietly, "but the form you now wear is your real body, like the butterfly and the grub of which I told you. Now, you can look at the books. You will not remember all you read, because there are some thoughts you may not carry back to Earth. But the king will let you remember 7 stories, which you can tell to the children of your world. They will believe them, but you, ah, you will say they are dreams. Oh no, I won't, I said eagerly, because it would not be true. This is not a dream. No, it is not a dream, he said sadly, but you will think it to be so. Never. Oh yes, you will. Mortals never believe. I turned angrily away at this remark, but when I looked again to reply, fancy had vanished, faded away like a wreath of snow in the sunshine, and I was alone in the beautiful room. Oh, it was truly a famous library, containing the most wonderful books in the world, but none of which I had seen before, except the fairy tales. In one recess I found the lost 6 books of Spenser's Faery Queen, the last tales told by Chaucer's Canterbury Pilgrims, the end of Coleridge's Christabel, some forgotten plays of Shakespeare, and many other books which had been lost on earth, or which the authors had failed to complete. I learned afterwards that they finished their earthly works in Farallond, and that none of the books they had written during their lives were in the library, but only those they had not written. You will not know the names of the books I have mentioned, because you are not old enough to understand them, but when you grow up, you will, no doubt, read them all. Not the fairy books, of course, but all the others which the men I mention have written. In another recess I found nothing but fairy tales. Jack and the Beanstalk, the White Cat, the Yellow Dwarf, and many others, which were all marked the Chronicles of Farallond. I do not know how long I was in the library, because there was no day or night, but only the soft glow of the moon lamp shining through the room. I read many, many of the books, and they were full of the most beautiful stories, which all children would love to hear. But as Fancy said, I only remember 7, and these 7 I will now relate. I hope you will like them very much, for they are all true stories in which the fairies took part, and there is more wisdom in them than you would think. The fairies understand them, and so do I, because I have fairy blood in my veins, but many grown-up people who read them will laugh, and say they are only amusing fables. The wise children, however, who read carefully and slowly, will find out the secrets they contain. And these secrets are the most beautiful things in the world. So now I have told you how I was permitted to enter Farallond. I will relate the stories I remember which I read in the fairy palace, and the clever child who finds out the real meanings of these stories will perhaps some day receive an invitation from King Oberon to go to Farallond and see all the wonders of his beautiful library. End of chapter. Chapter 2. The Red Elf. 1. How the Red Elf Ran Away from Farallond. Farallond lies between the Kingdom of the Shadows and the Country of the Giants. If you want to reach it, you must sail across the Sea of Darkness, which rolls everlastingly round these 3 strange places and separates them from our world. Then you journey first through the giant's country, the inhabitants of which are very like ourselves, only larger and fiercer, with very little spiritual nature in their enormous bodies. Afterwards you pass into Farallond, where the elves are bright, graceful creatures, who possess forms like ours, and not a little of our nature. Beyond lies the strange kingdom of shadows, where dwell things which have very little in common with our earth. They are the shadows of the past and the future, of what has been and what yet shall be. Mortals have strayed by chance into the giant's country, and in old stories we are told they have lived in Farallond. But no living man or woman has ever seen the kingdom of shadows, nor will they ever see it during life. Now, the fairies, being afraid of the shadows, never enter their kingdom, but they also never enter the country of the giants, because they despise them very much as being lower than themselves, much the same as we look down upon the uncivilized savages of Africa. Oberon, who, as you know, is the king of Faery, made a law that no elf should ever go into the giant's country, being afraid lest the fairies should learn things there which would bring evil on his own land. So when the fairies want to visit our earth, they do not cross the giant's country, but come in another way, which is known only to themselves. Having thus explained how these three countries lie, I will now tell you of a naughty elf, who, disobeying the king's command, lost himself in the giant's country, and of the difficulty he had in getting back to Farallund. The elf's name was Gillydrop, a beautiful little creature all dressed in clothes of a pale green tint, which is the favorite color of the fairies, as everyone knows who has seen them dance in the moonlight. Now Gillydrop was full of curiosity, which is a very bad thing, as it leads people into a great deal of trouble. And although he had never bothered his head about the giant's country before, as soon as he heard the proclamation of Oberon, he immediately determined to see for himself what the giants were like. Do you not think this was a very naughty thing for him to do? It certainly was, but he was punished for his disobedience, as all naughty people are, sooner or later. He spoke to two or three fairies in order to get them to join him, but they would not disobey the king's command and advised him to give up his foolish idea. "The king is very wise," they said, "and no doubt he has a good reason for not letting us visit the giant's country, so you ought to do as he tells you." "I don't care," replied naughty Gillydrop. "I'm sure there is something in the giant's country the king does not want us to know, and I am determined to find out what it is." So, in spite of all warnings, he spread his beautiful wings, which were spotted silver and blue, like a white clouded sky, and flew away through the woods. It was nighttime, for, of course, that is the fairy's day, but the way to giant's country was so long that by the time he reached the end of the forest, and came to the boundary of Farallund, the red dawn was breaking. So he crept into the bosom of a rose, and, after getting a honey supper from a friendly bumblebee, curled himself up to sleep. All through the long day, while the sun was high in the blue sky, he slept, lulled by the swaying of the flower, which rocked like a cradle, and soothed by the whisper of the wind and the buzzing of the bees as they hummed round his rose house. At last the weary, hot day came to an end. The silver moon arose in the dark blue sky. The wind sighing through the forest made the delicate leaves tremble with its cool breath, and the elf awoke. He left the kind rose, which had sheltered him in her golden heart from the heat of the day, and flew towards the rippling stream which lies on the confines of Farallund. Away in the distance, he could hear the murmuring laughter of the fairies, as they danced to the sound of elfin music, but he was too anxious to get into the giant's country to trouble himself about his old friends. Just as he was about to cross the boundary, the leaves of the fairy forest sighed out the word, "Beware!" But not heeding the warning, he flew across the stream and found himself at last in the terrible country where dwelt the foolish giants and the evil ogres. As he alighted upon an enormous daisy, which was as large as a mushroom, a voice rang out from Farallund, full and clear, like the sound of a beautiful bell. "Never more come back you need, till you've done some kindly deed." And so when Gillydrop looked back, he saw no green banks.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.